sisters and brothers in Christ, good morning. Welcome again to our lengthened reflection as we continue our journey through the season of Lent. Let me apologize for not having a reflection for last week, but guess what? This week, we will have two Lenten reflections to make up for last week. We cannot have them enough. And so when we started out, we looked at prayer. We looked at prayer as a conversation, communing and fellowshipping with God. We looked at, you know, the posture we should take on for prayer. And we looked at, you know, the whole sincerity that should surround prayer. That, you know, as much as we are seeking audience with God, God is also seeking audience with each of us. And that prayer is not something that we should take for granted. This week, as we continue the process of reflection, repentance, and renewal, we are going to be looking at worry. Why worry? Why worry? I know it's a part of being human. And at times, depending on what we're faced with, depending on the challenge, the trouble, the struggle, it is difficult not to worry. But here, in this particular scripture passage that we will explore together, God has given us the antidote, or Jesus rather, in the gospel according to St. Matthew chapter 6, verse 25 through to 34, has given us the antidote to not worry. And so we are going to explore that in this reflection as we talk about worry. Why worry? Do not worry. Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, thank you for being faithful, kind, and gentle. We pull ourselves away from the hurriedness and busyness of the day. We come, oh God, to be in your presence and to hear once more what it is that you have to say to us, to share with us. Lord, may we not take these times for granted. So much has changed. We have had to adapt. We have had to adjust. But God, you remain the same. Your message is the same. And I pray, Lord, that those in the hearing of my voice through the medium of this YouTube channel will receive your word and be challenged by your word and comforted by your word. Mighty God of Daniel, we ask you to speak to us with your word, so that as we rise from this reflection, our hearts are strengthened in you and we have an appreciation of what it is to trust you more. Bless us with your word as we look to you now, the author and finisher of our faith. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Bless your name, Jesus. I know.
I know that I can.
matter what may come my way.
No matter what may come my way.
My life.
My life is in.
Oh, hallelujah. With Jesus, I can take it.
With Jesus, I can take it.
I really love you, Jesus. With Him.
With Him, I know.
No matter what may come my way.
No matter what may come my way.
Hallelujah.
My life is in your hands.
Listen.
So when the tests and trials,
they seem to get you down.
They seem to get you down.
And all your friends and loved ones.
And all your friends and loved ones.
They're nowhere to be found.
Nowhere to
remember, remember,
found.
Remember, there is a friend.
Remember, there's a friend in Jesus.
Oh, I love Him, I love Him.
Who will wipe your tears away?
I know He will. And if
your heart is broken,
this is all you have to do.
Just lift your hands.
Oh, come on and worship with me. Say it, come on.
Oh, I know that I can get.
Don't you give up. I know.
I know that.
Hang on, joy is coming. I know
no
it.
No matter what may come my way.
Jesus, my life.
My life is in.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. With Him, I know I can take it.
Jesus, I can take
it. Thank you, Jesus. With Him, I know.
With Him, I know.
I feel like having some church in here. No matter
no
what may come.
What
yeah. Jesus, my life is in. Every person that's going through, lift your hands and say it with me. I know I can.
I know that I can make it.
I got a witness in here somewhere. I know.
I know that I
hallelujah.
Can.
No matter what may come my way.
No matter what
hallelujah.
May come my way.
Jesus, my life is in.
My life is in.
Oh, I love you so much, Jesus. With you, I know I can.
With Jesus, I can take.
Oh, bless your name, Jesus.
No matter what may come my way.
No matter what
may come my way.
Hallelujah.
My life is in.
Hallelujah. Come on and say it with me. I know.
I know that I can make it.
I know you can make it. I know you can.
I know that I
no matter what may come my way. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I know I can take it.
Jesus, I
feel it all in my spirit right now. I feel it. Thank you, Jesus. No matter what may come my way.
Oh,
thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. No matter what you're going through, His grace and mercy do it for her. He loves you. I know He does. Oh, hallelujah.
Let me read for us today from the Gospel according to St. Matthew chapter 6. I'm reading from verse 25 and I'm going to read through to verse 34. St. Matthew chapter 6, verse 25 through to 34. As always, I encourage you to have your Bibles open, ready to go through your notebook, your pen, your pencil, so that you can make your notes for deeper reflection or even for questions as you see it fit. St. Matthew 6, verse 25. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to his life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow? They do not labor or spin. Yet, I tell you that not even Solomon, in all his splendor, was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you? Or, O you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Isn't that true? We wake up in the morning, we maybe take some time to reflect and to do our personal devotion. Sometimes we don't do it that way. We get up and we start with the day's event, depending on what it is that we have to do and what is happening as well. The thing about a new day is that we do not know how the day will unfold. We have a plan. We think about the day, and based on the plan that we have, or we may not have a plan, and we, even with us not having a plan, we are hoping that the day will go smoothly, or that things will turn out or work out in the way that we would want it to be. But of course, life is so unpredictable. And even with our best plan, as soon as the day starts to unfold, things start coming at us that we did not plan for, imagine, or dream about. That is just how life is. So for us to be worrying without knowing what is awaiting us, that is adding more to what we are already dealing with. And I think this starting point about each day has enough trouble of its own is just simply saying to us, because we would have lived through the past days and we would have carried the troubles of those days, allow the day to unfold rather than starting the day predicting or thinking or willing something into being. So what does it mean to worry? Because we tend to worry a lot. And there are those of us who may worry more than others, because by human nature, we are made up different and we respond to things differently. And worry is a state of anxiety or concern about actual or potential problems. Let me say that again. It is a state of anxiety or concern about actual, meaning that this is the reality, this has happened, I know what is happening, and so there is cause for concern. But it also says potential problems. So being potential, it is possible that it may happen, but it's also possible that it may not happen. And it is oftentimes accompanied by a feeling of unease or fear. And people worry for various reasons. We worry for various reasons. The first reason, uncertainty. We are unsure about the outcome of a situation or an event, right? Uncertainty. We are not sure how things will work out. We're not sure in which particular direction something may go. We are just simply not sure. And when we are not sure about something, we can become very fearful about it, right? Because we are just not sure. We are uncertain. So we come with a sense of unease and we are fearful, particularly if we have some idea of how things can work out or turn out, all right? The other reason why we worry, fear of the unknown. of the unknown. Worry arises when individuals face unfamiliar or unpredictable circumstances, and we can understand that. We also worry when we have a great responsibility, either because we are not so sure of our competence, or our confidence may not be at the place that it ought to be. But those of us who are tasked with various responsibilities, and depending on the level of responsibility, we do worry because we want to make sure that at the end of the day, we do what we're supposed to do, and not just simply do it, but do it with the best of who we are. And sometimes, because our confidence level is not there, or we don't think that we are competent enough, worry can overwhelm us. We also worry because we anticipate, you know, what we call overthink. And I think these days, many persons are given more to overthinking situations and outcomes. So, you know, we overthink, and usually when we overthink, it is accompanied by negative thoughts, right? And we worry a lot when we are overthinking, having the negative thoughts, and we think that, okay, we are anticipating adverse consequences or failure. We also worry because of a lack of control. Part of being human is that we love to control things in our lives. And there are times when we are not able to do that. So we feel powerless. We feel as if we're unable to influence certain aspects of our life or events. As we go through this season of Lent, we want to ask God through the power of the Holy Spirit to help us to not worry as much as we do. And know that I did highlight some of the reasons why we worry. I think part of the reflection aids in the introspection or the reflection. And what I would encourage us to do, as I identified five major or broad reasons for worrying, maybe as we go through the rest of this lengthened reflection and do our own personal introspection, can you identify with one of the five reasons given for why you worry? It may be one, it may be two, it may be all of them. Because when we're able to identify why we worry, then I believe and think that we're not able to do something about it. Either we can do something about it from a psychological perspective by talking to somebody to help us to deal with those anxious moments, as well as we can commit our state of worrying, or the fact that we tend to worry a lot, we can commit that to prayer as we ask God to help us to not worry so much, but to trust God more in the circumstances of our life. Life can throw us in many directions, and the world that we live in today, because the world is rapidly changing, so we are dealing with wars, and wars that affect us in a socio-economic way, right? So because of that, we are also dealing with inflation, and we're dealing with the high cost of living, and we're dealing with the fact that we have all these bills to pay, our electricity bill, our water bills, our internet bills, all the bills that we can think of, right? We're also dealing with the fact that we are now living in a society in Jamaica where the crime and violence is so high. And the truth is that we can leave our homes, going about our business, and anything can happen. We're dealing with lawlessness. We're dealing with corruption and greed. We're dealing with the decay in our morals and our values and our ethics. We're dealing with the fact that we are growing up a generation that is so entitled, and they don't value life. They don't value right. versus wrong. You know, they believe that they can do as they please at the expense of somebody else. We're growing up a generation that has no interest in learning anything about God, righteousness, justice, and truth. We're growing up a generation that believes that whatever I need to do to get through, that is what I'm going to do. And that is worrying, because that has big implications for our future. It has big implications for what the future will look like. Then we deal with our personal challenges, illness of all sorts, diseases of all sorts. You know, a lot of people are lonely, and that can cause anxiety and fear as well. A lot of people are just trying to get over past hurts, right? A lot of people are dealing with broken hearts. And a lot of people, because of their current situation, they are not able to say or to think about in a positive way how the future will unfold for them. So we have a lot of things that can cause us to worry. So we turn to the gospel reading that was read earlier in this reflection. And Jesus teaches about not worrying, right? He's helping those in his hearing, because this particular scripture is a part of the Sermon on the Mount. And I am surmising that the fact that Jesus highlighted why worry about food, why worry about clothing, you know, why worry about these cares of life, I am thinking in my mind that then people made a big issue about it. And given that he's addressing a Jewish audience, and in Jewish culture you have particular diet restrictions, you know, foods that can be eaten and foods that should not be eaten, the halal, that which can be eaten, the haram, which that should not be eaten. And he's addressing a Jewish audience, and usually in those days, you know, Jews would put these restrictions in place for those who are not Jews, and maybe that in itself can be a barrier, or could have been a barrier. I am just reading the text and knowing the audience that Jesus is addressing, so this could be a possible reason. I'm not saying the only reason, but maybe at the time there was a lot of fuss about foods and various types of food, and you know, people wondering what is it that they're going to eat based on the customs, the religious customs and rituals of the day. Also, clothing, could the same thing could go for clothing, what you wear. And in those days, what you wore would also indicate who you are, right? And your class from which you came from, you know, and people would identify you by what you wore to say who you are in society. And people would get fussy about that, because people want to be considered or known to be somebody as well. And maybe Jesus, in observing how people were consumed about these particular things, thought to himself, hey, here you are worrying about things that provision can be made for, or things that really do not affect one's relationship with God as you think they do. Maybe in Jesus's mind, you're wasting your time to worry about things that, as it says in the scripture, you can't add a single hour to your life. You can't do anything to extend your life. In other words, the things that you're choosing to worry about in comparison to you having a relationship with God that will affect your life in the here and now and after, you are not concerned about that, but you are maybe concerned about what we could say, with the want of a better word, trivial matters. So I think Jesus is helping the people to weigh the things that they are choosing to worry about, and the fact that those things will not affect them in any massive or big way at all. And so he's assuring them, you're worrying about things that you do not need to worry about, because God has made provision for you. If God has made provision for the flower in the field, and the birds of the air. And you are more valuable than the flowers in the field and the birds of the air. Do you not think that God will make provision for you? It is God who is ultimately your caregiver. It is God who has put things in place. It is God who will supply all your needs according to God's riches in glory. And here it is that you're wasting your time focusing on the things that seeking to have a relationship with God that will allow for you to trust God. And back to my point earlier to why I believe Jesus would have been highlighting about the food and the clothing is because it would have been a mixed community. Strong Jewish population, because the gospel according to St. Matthew are written from a Jewish perspective to the Jews to help them to accept Jesus as the Messiah. And in that mixed population, of course, you would have had non-Jews that were considered to be pagans and lived their lives by another system. And so Jesus was now making a comparison. So he was saying, you know, you are children of God. You don't need to worry, because see the pagans over here, that is what they do. But because you ought to know God, and you ought to know that God is your provider, your sustainer, your source, the one who is there for you, looking after you, looking out for you. You know, you have to recognize that God will indeed provide for you. So don't do as the pagans are doing. That is their thing. Because their trust and confidence is not in a God that provides. Their trust and confidence is either in something else or someone else. And so here it is that Jesus now says, hear what? Rather than seeking to run after these things, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things will be given to you as well. In other words, what is important here? What is the priority here? Is your priority people, objects, goals, or other desires or things? In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is helping those in his hearing to have an understanding that God ought to be your priority. And when you seek after God and you seek after the things of God, then you come into an understanding of who God is, God's nature, God's character. You come to trust God in a particular way that will give you the confidence to know that even when things are rough, even when there is darkness and you can't see any light, even when your life turns topsy-turvy, even when you can't figure it out, when you're lonely, when you're broken, when nothing makes sense to you, Jesus is actually saying God will make a way where there seems to be no way. Because the truth is, in coming into a relationship with God, you shift the lens through which you see things. You shift your understanding about life in general, with God being the center of life. You shift your perspective. You widen your scope to have an understanding that God is all-powerful and almighty. Now, sometimes the challenge comes in because we already have a particular idea or way in how we want things to turn out or work out. What are some of the things that we want to happen, and how we want them to happen? And because it is God who has created us and knows even more than we know ourselves, it is God who has the foresight. We are limited in sight. It is God who is El Roi, who knows all things, and we are limited in our knowledge. And sometimes the way we think, or the things that we desire, or the know-how, or what we are expecting, God already knows that sometimes these things will not work in our favor. And I am saying it as bluntly as that, because God is all knowing, right? But from our human perspective or where we sit, this is what we see. And this seek ye now the kingdom of God is one that is saying to you and I, we have limitations in all aspects of our lives. But here is a God who is all-knowing and can see ahead of us and knows what's best for us. And sometimes God have to pull back. Or in other words, things don't work out the way we want to, because God knows that as much as it is difficult for us or how disappointed we are, in the long run, it will be better for us. I put it that way. And so here God is saying, you know, turn to me first. Turn to me first for help. Let me help you to work it through. And you don't need to understand to trust me. You need to trust me to understand. Our human nature says that we need to understand to trust. But God says we need to trust God to be able to understand, right? And that is why peace is connected to understanding, the peace of God that passeth all understanding. Because when we are knowing God and we are getting deeper into who God is, then as life will present itself and the challenges and all of that come, because we have that particular peace, which for me is a supernatural peace, then we are better able to put things in perspective. And so we will not be worrying as much, because we are saying to ourselves, boy, as much as this is a hard pill for me to take, as much as I am not able to deal with it, I am trusting on the other hand that God will work it out for me, right? You know, God is inviting us to take on his character, right? He's inviting us to obey him. He's inviting us to serve him. He's inviting us to make him the center of our entire being. We have a tendency to start out that way. We committed to prayer. We are trusting God. But because we're impatient and because things are not moving in the way that we want it to move, sometimes we get up and we take it back from God. Right? And that becomes a trust issue for us with God. And God is saying, no, you can trust me. You have more than enough evidence to trust me. You have my word with many stories how I have already come through for my people to trust me, right? Because again, you do not need to understand to trust. You need to trust to understand. And so he is pushing us in that particular direction. Make me the center. All that you desire and all that you hope to be, make me the center. And when you make me that center, then guess what? Things will eventually fall in place. And so, for example, you know, sometimes we have to choose between doing what God would be calling us to do, and we have other things in our lives to deal with or adjust. And most times we tend to choose, what is it that we want to do over God's thing? And I have found that when I make the decision to do God's business, the other piece them just fall into place. They just fall into place. I recently had this experience where, it's not an experience. On the third Sundays, my Sundays are long. Basically, every Sunday is long because I do two churches every Sunday, barring none. But sometimes on the third Sundays, I may have to do three because I'm interim for another charge. And so I don't only have St. Paul's and now would I have four other congregations from the Hamden charge. And I have to find ways to connect with the congregations in those charges. It's just what it is. We are short on ministers. The Constitution says no charge should go without a or they minister. And yes, the people appreciate that I'm just interim, but they're still looking for ways to connect with me. And the last third Sunday in February, I preached at St. Paul's. I left St. Paul's and I went to Reed's Friendship United Church. Now the journey to get to Reed's Friendship is not the easiest because the roads are terrible. I don't even call them road. It's just a river course I'm driving on. And then when I'm finished preaching and doing communion at Reed's Friendship, I came around to Hamden because they were having fellowship meal, a gathering, and I also needed to have a meeting. And so, you know, I'm passing there, I line up. So, and the road bad. So yes, I drive a high vehicle, but it's pier jumping up. So that's Sunday, so I leave home 10 to 8, most Sunday mornings. When I got home, it was 5 o'clock, and I did say all that I do. When I got home, I couldn't function. It's just a matter of trying to be still because emotionally, mentally, physically, and that carried over into the Monday. The Monday we had a funeral. So usually when I do a Sunday like that, Monday morning, I have to be still. I have to come back to. But I had a funeral, so I had to rush out. So there was no rest, anything. And then I had a meeting in Spalding the Tuesday. I was talking to God in my heart. I was like, God, I know I'm an integral part of this meeting. And I've given my commitment because it's one of our schools. I serve on the board. I'm on this committee. And we have matters. I'm a part of it. I need to deal with it. And I was in my heart saying, Lord Jesus, me tired. I'm going to go drive, God. Before the day was finished on the Monday, God just worked it out. I got a call saying that the chairman had a challenge. And so it seemed as if we may have to put off that meeting. Who could it be but God? My heart was concerned. I did God's business on the Sunday. And I did it with all I had within me. By the time I got to the Monday, we were sending home a colleague. So I know that Tuesday would have been difficult. But by Monday evening, God made a way. And so we were able to postpone the meeting. On Tuesday, I couldn't do anything. It's like everything just dropped down. So I listened to my body and I took the time to rest. And I know a lot of people can't appreciate this or even appreciate this about a pastor. But I'm sharing that to say, I sought to do God's business. And God, without me intervening and have to make a call to explain myself, God worked it out for me. That's just one of many examples. And I'm saying that to encourage somebody. If you choose to do God's business above your business, God will take care of your business. Right? So God is saying, come. Come to me first. Right? And sometimes we prioritize people, things, money, our emotions. Because as Christians, I find that many of us are emotive. So we allow our emotions to drive us rather than what we know about God. So we just simply feel. And because sometimes we have unresolved issues, they color or they get in the way. And here God is saying, choose me. When you choose me, let go everything else. Release it. Because guess what? It's in releasing those things that you release your worry and you allow me to take full control of whatever it is. Remember, it's a relationship, you know. And interestingly, in our other relationships, whether it's a marital relationship, whatever relationship we have, you know, we give all our trust and confidence. But when it comes unto God, there is sometimes something that blocks that. So seek ye first the kingdom of God. make me the priority. When you make me the priority, then I will take care of your business. And that is something experiential. It is something that we have to allow ourselves to experience. I don't have any formula. Things may work out different for different ones of us, depending on what is happening in our lives. Our relationship with God is personal and unique as well. But I do know at the end of the day, when you trust God and you do God, you take care of God's business, God will take care of your business. One of the things we have to pay attention to as Christians, and I know we love to romanticize, meaning that we don't tend to process life with all the sciences or disciplines that God has given to us. So when I talk about we romanticize, you know, we use our spiritual self to just cover everything. No, we're spiritual beings and God is the center of our life, so do not get me wrong. But it's the same God that has blessed us with the discipline of psychology, sociology, anthropology, you know, all the different things that we use in life to make life easier for us to live. And science is a gift from God. And one of the things we doctors will tell you is that some of the illnesses and medical challenges that people are wrestling with now is due to the fact that because of worry, people now become stressed, and stress is becoming a killer. So stress is advancing some of the illnesses in our bodies. Stress is damaging us mentally, physically, and emotionally, and I also say spiritually, stress. And I can speak to that personally because of what I do, by nature of what I do, it is solely centered around people. So you're a pastor, so you deal with everything about people's lives. So you deal with people's trauma, as well as their celebratory moments, their difficult moments. You know, as a pastor, you carry. And if we are not careful as pastors, we find ourselves overwhelmed with stress. And sometimes we just have to take a time out because we also have to think about our health. I know that there are some people who think that, you know, pastors don't need to do all of that. And that's unfortunate. But, you know, coming into 2023, I know that I personally needed a timeout. After 20 years, I need a timeout, because when I sat down and reflected on my 20 years as a pastor, there's no book or tongue to tell or for me to write, because she who feels it knows it. And, you know, so I was getting into that place where stress was really becoming that factor that would eventually cause me to just fray out, affecting my health, affecting me mentally and emotionally. And you just have to separate. So stress is becoming a major killer. And part of the cause of stress is the worrying dear about. And I want to think that Jesus's warning has its strong spiritual sense and meaning, but because we are a whole being, I believe that Jesus also knows that worry damages our health. And so we have to just do things and life a little differently, because God in creating us did not create us to worry. He created us to worship him and to give him the best of who we are. But as I said, life has changed and it has become so hurried and busy and complex that we have to learn to manage ourselves. The other thing too is that worry, you see, cause the object of our worry to consume our thoughts. So when we worry, we are consumed by the object of our worry, that thing that is causing us to worry, rather than laying that thing at the foot of the cross, one, and also maybe making some decisions about some of the things in our lives that is causing us to worry. Sometimes I think we forget that we have full control of our lives, right? But sometimes we allow other people and things to control us and to consume us in a way that we lose ourselves. So we focus on the object of the worry rather than focusing on God, so that we can find the peace of God to help us to navigate. Because the truth is, you know, life will always have challenges. Life will always have challenges. The other thing I believe that Jesus is guarding us against is, you know, we ought to know that worry can disrupt productivity. Worry can disrupt productivity. So when you become stressed out and tired and distressed and depressed, you also become dysfunctional. We're unable to function any at all. Mentally, we can't think straight. Emotionally, we experience so many different emotions. Sometimes we move from anger to frustration. We're crying. We're just all over the place. We don't have a sense of who we are, where we are, you know, mix up in the mind, in the heart, in the spirit, and that can affect productivity. Also, the other thing I believe is that worry sows negative thoughts and affects us negatively. It also affects the way that we treat each other and the way that we think about each other. Right? So it produces negative thoughts. We can't become optimistic. We become so cynical and pessimistic about life and people. And finally, worry reduces our ability to trust in God. Now, there is a big difference between worrying and being concerned. Worrying immobilizes you. What do I mean by immobilizes you? Is that you're unable to make decisions or to make good judgment. You're able to clear your mind to say, okay, this is a situation. What are some of the things that I can do to reduce this or to get rid of this? Okay? So it immobilizes. You're not able to function any at all, right? But when we are concerned about something, it can put us and move us to do something about it. So concern moves us into action, right? So there's a big difference between worrying and being concerned. When you're concerned about something, you want to do something about it. When you're worrying about something, you are immobilized and you can't function. You can't do anything about it at all. So from this particular scripture that I read, and we are focusing on worry, I just simply want to remind us that Jesus is offering an invitation for us to trust him. To trust him. I'm bringing up my script. As Christians, trust can be defined as having faith and confidence in God's promises, guidance, and character. Let me say that again. As Christians, trust can be defined as having faith and confidence in God's promises, guidance, and character. Yeah? When you're in a relationship with somebody, isn't that what you do? You're trusting and putting confidence in the promise that the person made to you, the guidance that the person can offer to you, and you're trusting the person's character to be what or who they say they are. Isn't that what we're doing? When we come into a relationship with God, it's the same thing. That having come to know God, and we are in a process of knowing God. Because the truth is in us, sisters and brothers, our relationship with God ought to be one that is experiential. We are experiencing God in our lives. And the more we experience God in our lives, we have faith and confidence in God's promises, guidance, and character. The second thing is that we have to prioritize. God ought to be the center of everything we are and everything that we hope to be. It means then that we place God first in our lives. And so it's the principles of God that are at the forefront of the decisions that we seek to make, our actions, our attitudes, as we align our will and our lives with the will of God and the nature and character of who God is. Put God first. Put the things of God first and watch God allow the other things in your life to fall in place. And finally, part of what we need to do is to take responsibility for our life, our actions, our words, our deeds, our thoughts, our lives. Yes, take some responsibility. We love to play the game blame too much, right? And being responsible means acknowledging our accountability to God for our actions, how we steward the resources that God has blessed us with, and the abilities that God has given to us, how we fulfill our promises and commitments and duty to God with integrity and diligence. Yeah, that is what it means to be responsible. So I believe that if we're able to trust God, ultimately, if we're able to put God first and to take responsibility for our actions, for our lives, for our words, our thoughts, our deeds, then I can see worrying dissipating from our lives. I can see worrying taking a back seat in our lives. So I invite you today to do as this text says. St. Matthew 3 verse 6. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things will be given unto you. Thank you for being with us as we contemplated what it means to worry, what worry is, the reason we worry, the antidote that God has given to us through St. Matthew 6, 25 to 34, and some of the effects of worrying, and what is it that we need to do so that we do not worry. I pray that the Lord will continue to bless you and keep you. I pray that this time of Lent is a really new experience. Yes, we go through it every year, but make this one a new experience. Desire it to be a new experience as we continue the process of reflection, repentance, and renewal. God bless you. Let us pray. Lord, you are faithful, you are good, you are awesome, you are excellent, and we thank you for who you are. And so, God, thank you for your word to us today. May your people not only hear the word, but may your people do the word. Holy Spirit, thank you for being patient and kind and gentle with us. Lord, we thank you for your grace that knows no end, your compassion, your mercy. And so, people of God, the Lord bless you, keep you, and give you his peace. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. See you in our next reflection. God be with you, now and forevermore.
I know that I can stand.
I know that I can stand.
No matter what comes my way.
No matter what may come my way.
Jesus, my life.
My life is in your hand.
Let's sing it together. Don't you be afraid.
And don't you be afraid.
Joy cometh in the morning.
Joy comes in the morning.
Troubles, they don't last always.
Troubles, they don't last always.
For there's a friend named Jesus.
For there's a friend named Jesus.
Who will wipe every tear.
Who will wipe your tears away.
And if your heart is broken.
And if your heart is broken.
Just lift those hands and
say. Just lift your hands.
Come on, sing it with me. I know I can.
Oh, I know that I can.
Bless your name, Jesus. I know.
I know that I can stand.
No matter what may come my way.
No matter what may come my way.
My life.
My life is in
you. Oh, hallelujah. With Jesus, I can take it.
With Jesus, I can take
it. I really love you, Jesus. With him. No matter what may come my way.
No matter what may come my way.
Hallelujah.
My life is in your hands.
Listen.
So when the tests and trials,
they seem to get you down.
They seem to get you down.
And all your friends and loved ones.
And all your friends and loved ones.
They're nowhere to be found.
Are nowhere to
remember,
be
remember,
found.
Remember, there is a friend.
Remember, there's a friend.
Oh, I love him, I love him.
Who will wipe your tears away?
I know he will. And if
your heart is broken,
this is all you have to do.
Just lift your hands.
Oh, come on and worship with me. Say it, come on.
Oh, I know that I can.
Don't you give up. I know.
I know that.
Hang on, joy is coming, I know
no
it is.
No matter what may come my way.
Jesus, my life.
My life is in your
hands. Hallelujah, hallelujah. With him, I know I can take it.
Jesus, I can take it.
With him, I know.
With him, I know I can take
it. I feel like having some church in here. No matter
no
what may come.
What
yeah. Jesus, my life is in.
My life.
Every person that's going through, lift your hands and say it with me. I know I can.
I know that I can take.
I got a witness in here somewhere. I know.
I know that I
hallelujah.
Can.
No matter what may come my way.
No matter what
hallelujah.
May come my way.
Jesus, my life is in.
My life is in.
Oh, I love you so much, Jesus. With you, I know I can.
With Jesus, I can take.
Oh, bless your name, Jesus.
No matter what may come my way.
No matter what
hallelujah. May come my way.
Hallelujah.
My life is in
hallelujah.
Your hands.
Come on and say it with me. I know.
I know that I can make it.
I know you can make it. I know you can.
I know that I
no matter what may come my way. Thank you, Jesus.
No matter what
hallelujah.
May come my way.
I know I can take it.
Jesus, oh, 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 oh.
I feel it all in my spirit right now. I feel it.
Thank you, Jesus.
No matter what may come my way.
No matter what may come my way.
Oh, hallelujah.
My life is in
your hands. Thank you, Jesus. No matter what you're going through, his grace and mercy. Do it for me. He loves you. I know he does. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah.